In previous videos, we saw how we can calculate the propagation of a coherent optical field. We saw that there are two ways to understand propagation. The first way is to decompose the field in the starting plane in plane waves. We can propagate each plane wave separately and then add the propagated plane waves together in the observation plane. This method is called the angular spectrum method, and it can be described using Fourier transforms. The first Fourier transform decomposes the initial field into plane waves. To propagate the plane waves, we multiply each plane wave by a complex phase vector, and then we take the inverse Fourier transform to add all the propagated plane waves back together. The second way to understand propagation of a field is by using Huygens' principle. According to this principle, each point in the initial field acts as a point source. To find the field in the observation plane, we must add the contributions from all point sources together. Using this principle, we can derive the Fresnel diffraction integral. To compute this integral, we multiply the initial field with a quadratic phase vector, and Fourier transform the result. Technically, the outcome should be multiplied with another phase factor, but if we're only interested in the intensity, then we can leave it out. If we consider far field propagation, the quadratic phase factor reduces to a constant, and the propagated field is simply given by the Fourier transform of the initial field. This is called Fraunhofer propagation. In the following, we will see how we can numerically simulate the propagation of fields in MATLAB using these two expressions. A useful reference for further information is Computational Fourier Optics, a MATLAB tutorial by David Vols. Note that both methods of propagation rely on the use of the Fourier transform. So naturally, let us first see how we perform a Fourier transform in MATLAB. To see how we can perform a Fourier transform, we define a circular aperture. We know from optics what its Fourier transform should look like. It should be an airy disk. So let's see if we can indeed obtain the airy disk. We could try to use the operation FFT, which stands for Fast Fourier Transform. But if we do this, we see that the outcome looks nothing like the airy disk. The reason for this is that the operation FFT doesn't take the two-dimensional Fourier transform of the entire aperture. Rather, it takes the one-dimensional Fourier transform of each column separately. To take the two-dimensional Fourier transform, we use the operation FFT2. But when we apply this operation, we still don't get the result we want. We do get an airy disk, but it is quartered and spread out on the four corners. Why is the airy disk not intact and centered as it should be? The reason is that, to obtain that result, we assume that the origin of our coordinate system is in the center of the matrix that we defined. However, when MATLAB performs a Fourier transform, it assumes that the origin is at the corner. The quartered airy disk that we saw is in fact centered around the corner of the matrix, which has periodic boundary conditions. To solve this problem, we apply the operation FFT shift. This operation rearranges the matrix so that the origin is shifted from the center to the corner. Then, the fast Fourier transform operation FFT2 applies the Fourier transform as intended, and then we need to apply another FFT shift to shift the origin back to the center of the matrix. If we now plot the amplitude and phase of the result, we find the result that we expect, an intact and centered airy disk. However, we do still see a linear phase. Why is the phase not circularly symmetric? A linear phase in the Fourier transform means that the aperture must be laterally shifted off-center. The reason for this is that our matrix consists of an even number of pixels. This means that we cannot define a single central pixel. If instead we use an odd number of pixels, we see that indeed the linear phase is removed. To prevent us from repeatedly having to type FFT shifts when performing a Fourier transform, we may define new functions that have the FFT shifts built into them. Now that we know how to perform a Fourier transform in MATLAB, we can already explore quite a few interesting optical topics, which we've discussed in previous videos. For example, we can simulate Fourier transform holography, which is a form of lensless imaging. we can define an object that we want to reconstruct from its far field intensity. To do this, we introduce a pinhole some distance removed from the object. To calculate the far field intensity, we take the squared modulus of the Fourier transform. To reconstruct the object from this measured far field intensity, we simply take the inverse Fourier transform. We see that thanks to the pinhole, we can directly extract the reconstruction of the object. Another topic that we can simulate is Zernike phase contrast imaging, or more generally, imaging with Fourier filtering. Here, we define a phase object that we want to image. To make the phase information visible in the image intensity, we apply Fourier filtering. So we first take the Fourier transform of the phase object. Then, in the case of Zernike phase contrast imaging, we shift the phase of the center of the Fourier transform, which corresponds to the light that is unscattered when passing through the phase object. To create the image, we take another Fourier transform of the filtered Fourier transform. Note that in the case of Fourier filtering, we use Fourier transforms to simulate the effects of the lenses in an imaging system, whereas in the case of Fourier transform holography, we use the Fourier transform to simulate far-field propagation. With Fourier transforms, we can also test iterative phase retrieval algorithms. We can define an object that we want to reconstruct from its far-field intensity pattern, and the support constraint that it should satisfy. To compute the far-field intensity pattern, we take the squared modulus of the Fourier transform of the object. To run the phase retrieval algorithm, we alternatingly enforce the intensity constraint and the support constraint. Such simulations can be used to, for example, investigate the convergence behavior of different phase retrieval algorithms, or to see how they are affected by measurement noise. So we know how we get the Fourier transform to look right, and we can already use it to meaningfully study several topics. But to quantitatively simulate the propagation of fields, there is still something we need to figure out, namely the axes with which we're plotting the Fourier transform. When we define some matrix and then take its Fourier transform, we simply get another matrix. But if we assign a physical meaning to the pixel of the matrix we start with, MATLAB cannot tell us the physical meaning of the pixels of the Fourier transform. It simply takes a meaningless matrix as an input and gives a meaningless matrix as an output. It is up to us to specify exactly what it is we're calculating. So let's start with a mathematical formula for the spatial Fourier transform. It takes in a function of position x, and it returns a function of spatial frequency fx. When performing numerical simulations, the position coordinate is discretized in capital N pixels. The nth position is given by n times the spacing delta x. The largest position coordinate is given by capital N minus 1 times delta x. And we define the length L as capital N times delta x. The integral can be approximated as a discrete sum over the discretized position coordinates xn. Note that there are not yet any restrictions on the spatial frequency fx. It can still be considered a continuous variable. However, when we perform a discrete Fourier transform using a fast Fourier transform algorithm in MATLAB, the output will be discretized as well, and the output has the same dimensions as the input. We can rewrite n using the expression for the discretized position coordinates. Plugging this in the expression for the discrete Fourier transform, we find an expression that we can compare with the discretized Fourier transform integral. So now we can rewrite the discrete Fourier summation in terms of the discretized spatial frequency. We find an expression for the discretized frequency, and with that we find that the interval between the spatial frequencies is given by 1 over L, where L denotes the field of view in object space. The largest spatial frequency that is sampled is given by 1 divided by the resolution in object space. We can thus summarize the relation between the axes in object space and Fourier space using MATLAB notation. The x-axis goes from 0 to L minus delta x in steps of delta x. The spatial frequencies go from 0 to 1 over delta x minus 1 over L in steps of 1 over L. These axes assume that the origin of the coordinate system lies at the edge of the vector, or at the corner of the matrix. But we saw that we typically use FFT shift to shift the origin to the center of the factor n matrix. An important conclusion that we draw from these expressions is that the field of view in object space determines the resolution in Fourier space. Conversely, the resolution in object space determines the field of view in Fourier space. Intuitively, we can understand this by noting that the field of view in object space determines the lowest frequency that can be defined, whereas the resolution in object space determines the highest frequency that can be defined. Therefore, if we want to increase the resolution in Fourier space, we simply increase the field of view in object space, which can be done by extending the object with zeros, which is called zero padding. This can be demonstrated using a simple MATLAB code. We start with an aperture that fills the entire field of view. So when we Fourier transform it, we obtain a low resolution array disk. When we zero pad the aperture, the resolution of the array disk increases. The more zeros we add, the higher the resolution of the array disk. Now that we know what the axes are if we take a Fourier transform in MATLAB, we can implement the formulas for angular spectrum propagation and Fresnel propagation. To implement angular spectrum propagation, we need to multiply the Fourier transform of the initial field with the phase vector e to the power ikz z. Here, kz is a function of the spatial frequencies. We can first express kz in terms of k, kx, and ky, and kx and ky are related to the spatial frequencies fx and fy by a factor of 2 pi. So we can write the complex exponential in terms of the Fourier coordinates fx and fy. This implementation of angular spectrum propagation can be used to simulate inline holography for lensless imaging. In inline holography, we have an object that is mainly transmissive and has small features that block the light. The light propagates freely, and then we measure the intensity. To reconstruct the small features of the object, we backpropagate the recorded intensity. The other propagation method is Fresnel propagation. In this method, we multiply the initial field with a quadratic phase vector and then take the Fourier transform. Assuming we're only interested in the intensity of the propagated field, we can ignore the phase vector in front. The axes of the propagated field are given by the spatial frequency axis multiplied with the wavelength and the propagation distance. We can now compare the two propagation methods. For small propagation distances, the angular spectrum method is accurate, whereas the Fresnel propagation method clearly does not give the right results. As the propagation distance increases, the two methods give similar results. Note that for the Fresnel propagation method, the field of view increases as the propagation distance increases. For very large propagation distances, the angular spectrum method starts to display numerical artifacts, whereas the Fresnel integral reduces to the Fraunhofer integral, which means that the propagated field is given simply by the Fourier transform of the initial field. We can take the square root of the amplitude to make the diffraction tilts more clearly visible. So we see that for short distances, the angular spectrum method yields accurate results, whereas for longer distances, the Fresnel integral is more accurate. The reason why this is the case has to do with how complex exponentials depend on the propagation distance z. For the angular spectrum method, the phase vector gets stronger as z becomes larger, whereas for the Fresnel integral, the phase vector gets stronger as z becomes smaller. To see how the strength of the phase vector affects the numerical accuracy of the Fourier transform, we can perform a simple simulation where we introduce a parameter a to vary the strength of a quadratic phase vector. We then plot the corresponding Fourier transform and see whether any artifacts are visible. Physically, what we're simulating is the focal spot of a thin lens as it goes out of focus. The stronger the quadratic phase vector, the farther we go out of focus, and the larger the focal spot becomes. At some point, the focal spot becomes so large that it fills the entire field of view. Recall that the field of view in Fourier space is determined by the resolution in object space. The resolution in object space also determines how steep a phase gradient we can still sample accurately. For example, If the phase gradient becomes so steep that two adjacent pixels have a phase difference of 2 pi, then because of the poor resolution, it will appear as if the phase is flat instead of steep. So what happens if we increase the strength of the quadratic phase factor beyond this point? When the gradient is so steep that we cannot properly sample it anymore, an effect occurs which is called aliasing, and it works as follows. We numerically calculate the Fourier transform within a finite field of view, but technically the Fourier transform is infinite in extent. Because of discrete sampling in object space, the full Fourier transform consists of multiple displaced copies of the field that we see inside the field of view. These copies are called aliases. As we increase the strength of the quadratic phase factor, so the focal spot goes further out of focus, the field becomes broader, and so do the aliases. At some point, they will become so large that they move inside the field of view. When this occurs, the computational result becomes unreliable, because what we see is not a physical effect, but a numerical artifact due to poor sampling of a steep phase gradient.